Good morning. Welcome to the bridge. It's good to see you all this morning. Happy Easter. Why don't you all stand? I'm going to sit. Why don't you all stand with us and we'll start worshiping the Lord this morning. Sense of you, of your presence, knowing that you are real and you are here with us this morning.
Father, we come before you this morning, and we thank you, Lord, for your love and your grace, your goodness and your mercy, Lord. Father, we thank you that you have risen, Lord God, that you are not in the grave. What a tremendous April Fool's joke for all the non-believers, Lord. You've raised, Lord God, and you're seated at the right hand of the Father. And because of that, Lord, we have access to the throne of grace. Because of that, we can gather together as a body of believers and worship and praise you, Lord, and celebrate, Lord. We are here to celebrate you, regardless of what's happened in our lives, what is happening, Lord, what might happen. Father, we're here because of you. We're here because you love us. We're here because we love you. We're here because we are seekers of God. Bless you, Lord. Be glorified this morning in our service. In Jesus' name, and God's people said, amen. Amen. Good morning. You may be seated. Welcome to the Bridge. My name is Pastor Ruben. I'm one of the pastors here, along with our lead pastor, Pastor Brian Kelly, we have Pastor Andrew Valle, and Pastor J.J. Johnson. Just want to welcome everyone here this morning. We're glad that you're here to celebrate Easter Sunday with us. We're glad that you're here simply just to be around God's people, just to be around people who are like-minded, people who love the Lord, people who are seeking to just try to get better one step at a time, one day at a time. We're not perfect, but we are reaching for perfection, and we won't reach perfection until we get to be in glory with the Lord. Amen? That's why we're here. That's why we worship God. That's why our hearts within us just soar to the Lord as we worship Him, as we put our minds and our hearts focused on Him. The Word of God says, if you search for Him with all of your heart, guess what? He's going to turn away from you. No, it doesn't say that. It says that He will. Not He could, not He should, but He will be found by you. Amen? Okay. A few announcements this morning. First of all, next Saturday, April 7th, we have our Kingsmen Ministry, and that will be at our downtown location on Cornwall Street, and it'll be at 9 a.m. from 9 to 11. So the Kingsmen is basically our ministry. It's a men's ministry where we get together as guys. We have some coffee, some donuts. We fellowship. We worship the Lord, and we study God's Word together. And it's a great time for guys to come and just start the day off with the Lord on a Saturday morning. So I encourage every man here, every old man, every young man, doesn't matter how old you are, to come out next Saturday at 9 a.m. to our downtown location for the Kingsmen Ministry. James and Azel Awesome, they had a baby. Praise God. They had, I don't know what, was it a boy, girl? Girl? All right, praise God. Okay, they had a little girl. And we have a meal train, so the signups are over at the offering table. So if anyone wants to help out to supply meals for them, that would be greatly appreciated. Also, April 15th, 2 weeks from today, we are going to have a baptism right after the service, and it's going to be right here. So if you want to be baptized, if you've confessed Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you acknowledge God, if you acknowledge that Jesus Christ died for your sins, but you've never been baptized, you've never taken the plunge, then I highly recommend that you do. So right after the service, just hang out and we'll dunk you and baptize you in the name of Jesus Christ. Jason, stand up for a minute. Jason wanted me to, and I just want everybody to look at Jason. What a handsome man. I just want... Jason, he's in charge of our setup and teardown crew, so we are in need of some extra volunteers. So if you are willing and able, please see Jason after the service and he'll set you up. Beginning in May, on Wednesday evenings, Pastor Brian, our lead pastor, will be teaching an in-depth Bible study through the Bible on Wednesday evening. So please be looking out for that date. It's going to be Wednesday evening. It'll be at our downtown location. And it'll be an in-depth Bible study, so he's really going to get into the nitty-gritty of what the Word of God says. It'll be interesting and exciting. So if you're new here today, again, I want to welcome you. And y'all have been here for a while. Welcome those who you haven't seen before right now. Say welcome.
Welcome.
Amen. Welcome, everyone. So we have these Connect cards. Or if you've been coming for a while and you're kind of thinking about being part of the Bridge and you're not sure, but you haven't filled out a Connect card, please do so. We just like to send you an email, keep you in touch of what's going on here at the Bridge. If you have any prayer needs, any prayer requests, you can put them on here. Hospital visits, visiting friends, whatever it is, we are available as pastors to serve you. So please, these Connect cards are at the offering table and they're also at the welcome table when you first walked in into the building. So these Connect cards are really, really good. I just have one more thing to say before Pastor JJ comes up. God has a plan and purpose for your life. Some of you guys are here for the first time. Some of you guys have been seeking God, looking for God, searching for answers. And I'm here to tell you that the only answer that you're going to get is going to be found in Christ Jesus. This world has nothing to offer you. Nothing at all. But God, through Jesus Christ, has a tremendous plan and purpose for your life. He wants to relate to you on a personal level. And I'm sure Pastor Brian is going to talk about some of that today. He wants to relate to you. He wants to love you because he's full of love. And many of us come to church on certain days. Now, I'm not downing anyone, please. I'm not downing anyone. All I want to do is encourage you to enjoy the body of Christ because we're all here together for the same reason. Because we're all seekers of God. Amen? That's what we are, seekers of God. And God loves you and God cares for you. And God wants to relate to you on a personal level. Through his son, Jesus Christ, who we're here today because of what he did. And because of his death on the cross, guess what? We all have the opportunity to live forever in eternity with him. This is just a training ground, you guys. Don't keep your eyes on this world. We're going to heaven. And it's going to be awesome. I wish I could tell you more about it. I had a dream. It was great. But anyway, it wasn't my turn to do announcements. It was Pastor JJ's turn, but I had so much stuff in my heart to just share with you guys. I just had to do it. So I'm sorry, okay? JJ's going to come up, and he's got an announcement for you guys.
Pastor Ruben. Hey, what's up, y'all? Hey, so a little different today. All the kiddos are in here with us worshiping. It's super fun to have you guys in here. So we're going to break for, like we usually do, we take a couple minutes so you can refill up your coffee. Get another donut because it's Easter and calories, they like cancel out. It's the crazy thing, it's funny. But while we do that, all the kiddos, you're gonna come with me and Stephanie. She's standing right there, look over, see her? So when we break for coffee and stuff, all the Bridge kids, you're gonna follow Stephanie and we're gonna go outside and we're gonna have, after our lesson, we're gonna have a fun Easter egg hunt, okay? Okay, so with that being said, why don't you guys take a couple minutes, stand up, refill your coffee, introduce yourself to someone, and Brian will be back up in a couple minutes. Thank you.
can come on in and grab a seat. We need to get like, we just started coming in the main entrance of the school last week, and I think we need to get like a speaker out in the hallway that has what's happening in here out there, or maybe just something completely different. But welcome, welcome to the Bridge. Happy Easter. Thank you. It's since the start of the early church, when the early believers would gather together, they would gather on the first day of the week, and from house to house they would gather and meet one another to study the scriptures and to hear from the apostles and to worship God, to celebrate communion together, and all the rest of the things they did. But a greeting that they would have, not just on Easter, but every time they would meet together, I don't know if they had ushers and greeters back then, but whenever they would see one another, they would say, the one person would say, "He is risen," and then the response would be, "He is risen indeed." And they didn't just do that on Easter Sunday, they did that every time they gathered together, because the resurrection, especially back when the church first started, was such a central part of their faith, and today the resurrection is still the center of our faith. We have hope, and we have our faith because Jesus is not dead, he has risen from the dead. So I'm going to greet you this morning. I'm just waiting for everybody to come in, and I'm going to say to you, he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Great. Yeah, we're just like the early church. Awesome. So can we do it next week too? Just to keep the pattern going? Great. The resurrection of Jesus Christ, what a wonderful thing to celebrate and what a central part of our faith. And we're going to be talking about that this morning, and we're going to be in the book of John, the Gospel of John, chapter 19. If you have your Bible, you can turn to John chapter 19, and we'll be looking at the resurrection. Resurrection reactions. Let me pray, and then we will get right into our study this morning. Before I do pray, I just want to give a special thanks to Pastor Ruben for doing those announcements. Were they announcements, though? Because I feel like I got saved and everything, and it was just like these are some great announcements. I'm like, my spirit is lifted up, and I know when the men's ministry is. Good job, Pastor Ruben. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for a wonderful, wonderful day in which to worship you, and in particular, Lord, this morning we want to remember not just your death on the cross for us, but the resurrection from the dead, without which our faith would be meaningless, would be worthless, would be just like every other religion in this world. But we have a different faith. We have a unique religion. We have a relationship with you because you have risen from the dead. Help us, Lord, as we study your word, to really learn and to grow in our faith, and maybe for some to begin that faith for the very first time. Lord, I pray that you would give me the words to speak, that you would speak to us, and that we as a church would have ears to hear what the Spirit says to the church this morning. We want to pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Resurrection reactions. Now, many of you know that we had a team, a small team of 8 people from the Bridge that just 2 weeks ago, it was 2 weeks, 3 weeks ago, traveled to Israel to go on a tour of the Holy Land. It was amazing. I had been there before, but I had never done a tour like this, and everybody else that came on our group had never been there before. And at each one of the sites, and we visited a lot of places. It seems like it was nonstop from 7 in the morning till 7 at night, just visiting these different sites of the Bible, from the Old Testament, from the New Testament. But some of the most special, at least for me and for many on our team, and spectacular, were the sites surrounding the life of Jesus. The very last day, we were able to visit the Garden Tomb, the actual place where Jesus was crucified and where he was buried and where he was risen from the dead. And as we each went to the tomb, there were many people there that day, and they would let people go in 2 or 3 at a time into the empty tomb, the Garden Tomb there in Israel and Jerusalem. And as we would go in, there were different responses. Some were crying, some were just smiling, some were somber and sober about just the feeling of the place itself. But everybody had a reaction to these different sites, and especially to the empty tomb that we were at. What I want to talk about this morning is our reaction to the resurrection. Now, if we had that reaction as a tour group in 2018, can you imagine, well, you don't really have to imagine because it's written down for us, but can you imagine the reaction of those early disciples, those early, actually the first people to see the tomb were the women that were part of the disciples of the larger group of followers of Jesus. Can you imagine their reaction to the empty tomb, to the angels that were there that said, "He is not here, for he has risen," just like he said? To see the reality of the resurrection, we can see their reaction from the time. So what I want to do is I want to read this passage of Scripture, and then I want to make a couple of points of application, because I think we would be doing ourselves a disservice if we just read the story and remembered the cool resurrection story at Easter time without making application to our own lives, because the reality is the grave is still empty. He is still risen. He is still alive. And therefore, we have the reaction even today. I want us to react in three ways. Now, everybody's going to be different, and this message will speak to you differently for each person wherever you're at in life. But there's three things that I think from this passage of John chapter 19, verse 41, to John chapter 20, verse 23. In this passage about the resurrection, there are three reactions that I want us to have as a church and as a people gathered here this Easter Sunday, 2018. Three things. My prayer as a reaction would be, number one, to believe, number two, to belong, and number three, to be bold. These were all the reactions that the early disciples had. To believe, to belong, and to be bold. And that's hopefully what we're going to get out of this passage today that we can take with us, because every Sunday we're going to say, "He is risen, he is risen indeed." You already told me you're going to do that next week, right? Let's see if I can remember. You can remind me. But to carry these things outside of this room into our lives. To believe, to belong, and to be bold. Let's read the passage and just reflect on this. If you don't have a Bible, you can just listen as I read. If you have a Bible, you can read along. But let's read the story, the resurrection story, and then we're going to look at those three points at the end of the message. Verse 41 of chapter 19. It says, "Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, which no one had yet been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and she saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and she went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, 'They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, going toward the tomb.' Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen clothes lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. And he saw the linen cloth lying there, and the face cloth which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloth, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed." Verse 9, "For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. And as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb, and she saw the two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. And they said to her, 'Woman, why are you weeping?' And she said to them, 'They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him.' Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, 'Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?' Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, 'Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away.' And Jesus said to her, 'Mary.' And she turned and said to him in Aramaic, 'Rabboni,' which means teacher. Jesus said to her, 'Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and to your Father, to my God and your God. And Mary Magdalene went, announced to the disciples, I have seen the Lord, and that he had said these things to her. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were, for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, Peace be with you. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld. We're going to stop there. This is a great passage of Scripture, and I think, just the simple reading of it can bring encouragement to our hearts. It says, after Jesus appeared to the disciples, they were filled with joy. That's kind of the understatement of the century, right? To see the one that they had believed in, the one that they had hoped would bring salvation, that he had been crucified and their dreams and hopes were shattered, but to see him alive again, they remembered that he had told them, I must die. I must die for the sins of the world, but I will rise again. Let's talk about those three things that I mentioned in the beginning. Going back to John 19, we're going to talk about the first reaction. And the first reaction they had was to believe. Back in John 19, verse 35, we didn't read this, but I'll just go ahead and read it. It kind of introduces the whole story by John, who had written the Gospel of John, testifying to the truthfulness of what he saw. Verse 35 of 19 says, He who saw it has borne witness, and his testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, so that you also may believe. Why were these things recorded? Why do we, 2,000 years later, have such an accurate eyewitness testimony of the resurrection of Jesus Christ? The answer is, so that we would believe. You see, that's the first reaction that we should have upon hearing of or seeing the empty tomb, is faith. To believe that Jesus is who he said he is. That he has done what he said he would do. That our sins are forgiven and that our life can be different from this day forward. We can be sure of that because we believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. To believe. The resurrection was the event that led to their faith and the continuation of their faith. The reason why we're here today in Bellingham, Washington, at Shuckson Middle School, and for many other congregations around Whatcom County, the reason why we are here is because they saw and believed in the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. That's the center of our faith. Without that, we would have nothing. Can I read a passage to you, 1 Corinthians chapter 15? 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 to 8. And this is Paul the Apostle, who also saw the Lord Jesus after his resurrection. He said, For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, that's Peter, he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, then he appeared to more than 500 brothers all at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. So what is Paul saying? The great theologian of the early church is saying, the reason why we're doing this is because we saw Jesus after he had died and had risen from the dead. Not only did I see him, not only did the 12 see him, not only did the women see him, but over 500 people saw him at one time. Jesus wanted to make sure that beyond the shadow of a doubt, we would have this testimony that he is risen from the dead. When you say, I believe in Jesus, that he's alive today, you're not saying it just based on some faith that someone told you to have. You're saying it based on the facts and the eyewitness testimony of those who had seen him there in the beginning that we read about. It's interesting that James, the brother of Jesus, you realize Jesus had other brothers and sisters, right? Same mom, different dad kind of thing. I don't know why I always say that. I just like saying this, like, whoa, God was his dad. brother of Jesus didn't even believe that his brother was a savior. How would you like to have Jesus for a brother? Yeah, son of God, savior of the world, Messiah that we've been waiting for? Yeah, okay, whatever. James didn't believe in Jesus until after the resurrection, because the resurrection causes that proof in which we are confronted with the fact either to believe or not, and we say, I believe. There's a Bible scholar, apologist, William Lane Craig, who writes about the resurrection, very, very good stuff, but I love what he said about James. He said, now most of us have brothers. What would it take you to convince, or what would it take to convince you that your brother is the Lord? Such as you would be ready to die for that belief. Can there be any doubt that this remarkable transformation in Jesus' younger brother took place because, in Paul's words, then he appeared to James? We just read that. You realize James, the brother of Jesus, was one of the first people in the early church to be put to death for his faith in Jesus and the resurrection. Now, it's easy to believe something to the point where, you know, it doesn't make any difference in your life, but to believe to the point of giving your entire life, even laying down your life for this belief, that's something remarkable. Josh McDowell, who was once a skeptic and now a believer, said, here's the simple answer. Within weeks, the disciples proclaimed the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that he had been bodily raised from the dead, and he had appeared to them. This made the difference. He really did resurrect. They really did believe. N.T. Wright, an eminent British scholar, concludes, quote, that is why, as a historian, he said, I cannot explain the rise of the early Christian church unless Jesus rose again, leaving an empty tomb behind him. You see, today we can go see the empty tomb. It's 2,000 years later. But when they were saying Jesus is risen, they knew exactly where the tomb was, who owned it, where it was. They could go see. And that's why the skeptics or the enemies of the church didn't say that Jesus is there. They said he's not there because the disciples stole the body. Isn't that what the scripture records? Because the tomb was empty. Now, again, coming back to the fact that all these disciples, except for one, John, were put to death for their faith. That's kind of ridiculous to be put to death for something that you know wasn't true. They believed it to be true. They saw it. They saw the risen Lord Jesus Christ, and they gave us a testimony. And so their reaction, much like our reaction, should be to believe. So I'm hoping that is why you're here already on Easter at church, because you believe, but it's just to solidify that faith. Look at verse 8 in John chapter 20. In verse 8, John chapter 20, we read it. The other disciple who had reached the tomb first. By the way, I love this story because you can still see, even in the midst of this spiritually significant event, there's still a little competition between the two. John is writing this, and he doesn't name his name. He's like, there was another disciple there, and he outran Peter. Just an FYI. Like, what does that have to do with anything? Like, I outran him, so. And then he went in first, but I was there first. These guys. Verse 8 of John chapter 20. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in. And I love that at the end of verse 8. He saw and believed. He saw. What is the reaction? To believe. And that's ours. That's ours as well. We believe based on the scripture and the eyewitness testimony of these early believers. And actually, we have a special blessing. Do you know that? Those of us who are born so many years later than this actual historical event took place. Look at this verse, John chapter 20, verse 29. In John chapter 20, verse 29, Jesus said, have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. That's us. That's us. We have a special blessing, more so than the early disciples, because we believe, having not seen him physically, we believe the report, that accurate report that they had written. In John chapter 11, verse 25 and 26, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet he shall live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? our first reaction is to believe. I love what another English pastor who's since passed away, but his name is John Stott. He said, "We live and die. Christ died and lived. We live and die. Christ died and lived. The difference between him and everybody else is the resurrection from the dead." And that's what we believe, and that's what we celebrate today. Secondly, to belong. In verse 17 of John chapter 20, as those women went to the tomb, Mary Magdalene and the others, they went back and gave the report. The guys had a foot race to the tomb, John 1. They went in, they saw, and they believed, but there was a further reaction that they had, and this is what we should have as well, and that was to belong. Why do I say this? Look at verse 17. In verse 17, Jesus said to her, and this is after they had gone back home, but Mary was still there. She didn't recognize him at first. But he said to her, "Mary," and she turned and said, "Rabboni," which means teacher. He said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers." That word brothers is actually a literal translation, brothers and sisters. The family, the brothers and sisters in the family of God. It says, "Go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." What is he saying here? He's saying, those that believe, that's our first reaction, is to believe in the resurrection. But those that believe, there's a further step to take, and that is to belong. It's one thing to believe in a fact of the resurrection. It's quite another thing to belong to the family of God. You see where I'm going with this? So what we want here on this Easter Sunday, this Resurrection Sunday, is not just to intellectually believe something, but to actually take that next step and to belong to something, and that is to the family of God. Jesus says, "Don't hold on to me. I still basically have some things to do before I go." And he said, "I want you to go," and there's two very important things he says. He talks about those other believers as his brothers and sisters, and he talks about God being not only his Father, but also, what did he say in verse 17? I'm ascending to my Father and your Father. What he's saying here is very significant, that the resurrection, not only does it cause us to believe, but it causes us to belong. Before this, we had no right to be part of the family of God. And because of the resurrection, we now have the opportunity. Look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 to 4. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again into a new life, into a new family, born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance." An inheritance is something that we receive as being part of a family, isn't it? "To an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for you." We're part of the family of God, receiving the inheritance of God, experiencing the blessings of God, because as it says here in 1 Peter, because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. It's more than just being saved. It's being part of a family, being part of a new life. And this is the point I want to make, that we can belong because of the resurrection. There's a theologian, Sinclair Ferguson, who said, "We are adopted into God's family through the resurrection of Christ from the dead, in which he paid all of our obligations to sin, the law, to the devil, in whose family we once lived. Our old status lies in his tomb. A new status is ours through the resurrection." I love that last part of it, that's why I wrote it down there. Our old life, our old status of being part of this world, part of the family of really the devil, I hate to say it, but it's biblical and scriptural. We're being part of that, is in the tomb now. Our new life is with God, and that's our new family. I love baptism, and one of the reasons why we're doing a baptism so close to Easter is because baptism really, visibly, as you go in the water and out, represents old life, down, man down. New life, up. What did you say, Reuben, about the announcements of the baptism? Get dunked or something, or take the plunge? Man, that's some good stuff. What is the April Fool's thing you said about in the prayer? Oh yeah, Jesus is dead. April Fool's is alive. Wah, wah, wah. See, I'm not the only pastor with bad jokes here at the bridge. Praise the Lord. Oh, I'm sorry, brother. He likes the prayer. Yeah. Oh man, it's disrespectful, huh? the reaction? What is the reaction we have? Hopefully this is kind of as it did with us as we were there in Israel, and it kind of hits you to believe, whoa, this is, you know, our guide that we were with kept saying, you know, some of these stones and things were rebuilt and things like that, but there were certain stones that you walk on. These, Jesus, without a shadow of a doubt, walked on these steps, on these stones, in this place, in this old synagogue they recovered. And just to have it, like, just, it's like, hits you, boom, and the reaction is, whoa, this is the real deal. This isn't just a made-up thing some dude came up with in his basement. This is real life. This is what God really did. The reaction to believe, and then taking that second step to belong to the family, be part of this. It's not just outside looking in, intellectual belief, but actually accepting that invitation to be part of God's family through the resurrection. And then finally, we'll close with this, to be bold. Isn't this the final response for those of us who have believed due to the resurrection? That we belong because of the resurrection, but we are called to be bold with that power of the resurrection. And that's exactly what they did in this story, verse 19 to 23. I kind of debated whether to end at verse 18, but I love this final story because it gives us a call as believers, as those who belong, to be bold in the name of Jesus Christ. It's kind of the what happens next, right? Here's the resurrection. It happened. Eyewitnesses, they believed. Great. Celebrated at Easter. Wonderful. Tie it all up. Let's go home. Not so fast. We have a job to do, right? We have a responsibility. In verse 19, on the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked, so they were scared. It's the very opposite of being bold, right? Quick, lock the doors. It wasn't even the Roman government they were afraid of, but their own Jewish leaders. Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, peace be with you. He said it again in verse 21. Peace be with you. Here's the first thing we can be bold about. Boldness means peace during persecution. I talk about this probably every week, but we don't necessarily deal with persecution to a large scale here in the United States at this time. We have freedom to worship and to gather as we please, religious freedom. But many people around the world are experiencing persecution, and it's part of our expectation as believers that we can expect in one way or another to be opposed or persecuted for our faith. But boldness means we have peace in the midst of that. I've said it before, and I'll say it again, the most peaceful, joyful Christians that I've ever had the privilege of spending time with, except for the bridge people, of course, are believers in countries where they are persecuted, where they have to gather secretly. And this is an amazing thing. It's like, this shouldn't be that people who are experiencing suffering, loss of job, loss of money, loss of everything, some even of their lives, should be so joyful and full of peace and content. How is it possible? This is exactly how it's possible, because of the power of the resurrection. Jesus came into a room where they were afraid for their very lives and says, peace. Peace be unto you. You don't have to be afraid anymore, because what can they do? Kill you? They killed me, and here I am, right? That's kind of the statement of the resurrection. You can't do anything to believers in Christ, because even if they kill the body, they cannot kill the soul and who you are as a believer. You'll resurrect again. This is a great thing. Boldness means peace, even during persecution. John chapter 16, verse 33. I have said these things to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. We have confidence, we have peace, because our Lord, our Savior, has defeated sin and death and the devil and the world and everything that could come against us. He has risen above it, and he says, take my hand, you can rise above it too. Peace in the midst of persecution. John 14, 27, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives do I give you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Boldness also means having the Holy Spirit as they were being sent. In verse 21, he says, as the Father has sent me, I'm sending you. So number one, we can have boldness. How does that manifest itself? Peace during persecution. Secondly, the Holy Spirit for the purpose of sending us. God is sending us. He's also empowering us. There's a great scripture here in John chapter 14, just before Jesus was crucified. Let's look at this quickly, and then we'll close with my next little sub-point here about boldness. In John chapter 14, verse 16 to 17, Jesus said, I will ask the Father. So he's saying, I'm going away. Basically in Jesus' mind, he knew he'd be crucified, dead for 3 days, resurrected, ascended to the Father. I'm going away, but I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. And in a fulfillment of that statement in verse 22 of our passage in John 20, when he had said this, he breathed on them and he said to them, after the resurrection, he said to them what? Receive the Holy Spirit. You see, I'm sending you to do a job for me, to do on a mission for me, to be bold for me, but I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm going to send with you the Holy Spirit, who will not only be with you, but as Jesus said, will also be in you. You as believers, as those who belong to the family of God, have received the power of the Holy Spirit living inside of you. We have a great cause to be bold. And then finally, boldness means faith in God's forgiveness in verse 23. And this is something I think a lot of people need to hear. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness, it is withheld. Basically, what Jesus was saying theologically here was that now that the death has been accomplished, the sins have been forgiven, the resurrection has happened, you as my family, as those who believe and those who belong, you have the ability to proclaim in the name of Jesus either your sins are forgiven or not forgiven based on your response to Jesus. I can tell you with full authority, and you can as well to others, that if you put your faith in Jesus Christ, your sins will be completely forgiven. 100%. Because he says, this is Jesus who just raised from the dead. I'm telling you that if you believe, your sins will be forgiven. For by grace you have been saved through faith, putting your faith in his finished work of death, burial, and resurrection. That's great. At the same time, we can say if you do not believe in Jesus, the only one who can forgive your sins, then your sins will not be forgiven. Here's what I think a lot of people need to hear, Christians I'm talking to. Maybe you're here this morning. I think a lot of Christians need to have boldness, not so much boldness to be strong in the midst of persecution or to have peace, not so much necessarily boldness to go out and share your faith, though all of us need that, by the power of the Spirit, like we talked about. But I think a lot of us, myself included from time to time, need boldness to truly believe that all of our sins are forgiven. Because, I'm just going to speak for myself at this point, we mess up a lot, right? We make mistakes. You're like, but you're a pastor, you shouldn't make any mistakes. That's Reuben, not me. I make mistakes. No, he makes mistakes too. Let me tell you about this one time he knows. A lot of people need to hear that, just to be honest with you guys. They have a hard time truly believing that God could forgive a person like them for what I've done, for the mistakes I've made. And they have a lack of recognizing that God has cleansed them completely. They may not be living a perfect life like Reuben was talking about today, but you need to know this. If you've put your faith in Jesus with all of your heart, and you've trusted in him and his death on the cross, and you believe that God raised him from the dead, you are forgiven and you are saved. And you need to be bold to walk in that message, because it's only when you believe that do you start to live in the power and the boldness of the life that he's called you to live. Does that make sense? So you can smile this Resurrection Sunday, even though you really messed up this week. Like, how did he know? Or last week. When was it? Even though you've messed up, even though you will mess up again, you can walk in joy and confidence that Christ has forgiven your sins, and he's at work right now in his resurrection power, to change you into the person he wants you to be. Be encouraged. Be strengthened. And that's the message I think God has for us as we close this. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's the true message of Easter, is that Jesus has risen from the dead. You believe that. How do we react to that? We believe that. We take that next step and say, I want to belong to the family of God. Not just to believe it, but to belong. And then finally, what is my response now? My reaction is to be bold in the name of Christ in those three ways that we talked about. All right, Easter, go and have a nice time today with your friends and family. We're going to have a worship team come back up and sing a couple more songs. And let's stand together, and we're going to celebrate in these final two songs. I almost dismissed everybody on accident. Sorry. You're like, really? We get to go now? No, you have to stay. Two more songs. Oh, man. I love you guys. I'm glad you're here with us at the Bridge if you're visiting. Let's sing these last two songs and really reflect on, obviously, the resurrection. We'll have the time of offering like we usually do every Sunday for the last song. But just really reflect on that. And I want to give you an opportunity, and I think I know most of you, and I assume probably many of you are believers already or belong already, as we talked about in the message. But I just want to give you an opportunity that I do from time to time to accept the reality of Jesus Christ for yourself, to belong to the family of God. If you're unsure, I'll give you a chance to respond, because it happens in your heart. You know, this is a heart thing, and we don't have to raise our hand or come forward or do anything. It's all in the heart. But you know what? I find it helpful to make that decision and say, that's me. I want that. I want to be sure today. So I'm going to ask you during the prayer that if you want to receive Jesus, you can raise up your hand. So let's bow our heads and close our eyes. I'm going to pray for you guys. I'm going to pray for us all, and then I'll give you that opportunity during the prayer. Lord, thank you so much for another great Sunday, and this is just a special Sunday because it is today more than any other day that we, as Christians around the world, remember the powerful, majestic work that you've done in resurrecting from the dead. This is incredible. You are the only one who has ever risen from the dead to never die again, that you are alive today. And so we want to just say thank you. We love you so much for that. At this time, if there's anybody here that would like to be sure or to accept Jesus for the first time or to be confident that you're part of the family of God, maybe you've believed intellectually, but you have never really received that invitation to be part of God's family, I'm just going to pray for you right now. I want you to raise up your hand right now, and I'm going to pray for you. So just raise your hand if you want to receive. Yes, I see you. Anybody else? Raise up your hand and say, this is the day I want that to be true of me. Easter 2018, make this the day that you truly belong, that you're confident. Is there anybody else before I pray? Don't let it pass by. Yes, I see you in the back too. Anybody else? Just raise your hand and I'll pray for you. Praise the Lord. Let's pray together. Lord, we just thank you so much for those who have raised their hands and have said, this is the confidence that I want, that I belong to the family of God. And according to the scripture that Jesus had told his disciples, of which we are part of his disciples today, I want to tell you that your sin from this day forward, the sins that you have committed, the sins that you will commit, they're all forgiven. In the name of Jesus, they're forgiven, because he died on the cross for you and he rose from the dead, and you've accepted that by faith. So congratulations. And Lord, we want to pray for all of us now that you would help us to walk in the victory of the resurrection, the boldness, that we would be bold. No matter what's happening in our lives, no matter the difficulties, we would be bold to spread your word and to tell others about this great gift. And then finally, Lord, that we would be so, so bold to believe all that you've said that is true about us, that our sins are forgiven. They've been washed whiter than snow. Praise you so much, Lord, for this Easter, and we pray that as we close in these two songs, you would be glorified and you would be honored. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
let's pray for this morning's offering. Father God, we come before you again, and we thank you, Lord, for all that you've done in this service in the hearts of your people, Lord, through the precious power of your Holy Spirit. Now we just simply want to give back to you the first fruits of what you've given to us, Lord God. We thank you so much for all that you have given us, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Lord Jesus, as we sing this last song, I'm reminded, Lord Jesus, this morning that you don't just give us a power to go and be with us, Lord. It's not this thing that you separate from yourself, Lord. You give us you in your fullness, Lord Jesus. And I praise you for that you are near. You're with us, Lord, that you've conquered the grave, you've conquered sin and death and hell and the devil, Lord, and we as believers are alive in you. We are free like you are because you are in us and with us, not just something you give us and you're way up in heaven. You're with us this morning, and I thank you and I praise you for that. Happy Easter again, everyone. Feel free to hang out for a little bit longer.